now. It's the Freedom Feens Live Talk Radio Show. I am Nima Vedati here in Austin, Texas. We've also got Michael W. Dean out there in the Wormabago. Where are you at today, Michael?
This is Mr. Michael Dean broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker at an undisclosed location in the rural Wild Mountain West in the occupied states of America. And today, my wife and I are in the mobile command unit, mobile broadcast unit, the Wormabago. And we are in Beast Lick, Wyoming, which is next to beautiful, beautiful Beast Lake, Wyoming. It's one of the great salt lakes of Wyoming. And there's natural salt lick formations on the side of it. And the antelope and the bison come up and lick it. So this little village, I think it's got like 46 people, is called Beast Lick, Wyoming. That's where we are today.
Huh. All right. Good. You eating some good barbecue out there in Beast Lake?
Yeah.
Planning on grilling some beasts up for yourself?
Yeah.
Roaming buffalo?
If anybody's driving by and sees the Wormabago, it says worms on the side of it, and it's got the satellite dish on the top of it. If the light that says on air is off, come up and knock on the door if you're friendly, and we will have some coffee with you and maybe share some beast with you here in Beast Lake, Wyoming.
Beast. Excellent. All right, so what's our show title today, Mr. Dean?
I was going to ask you.
Oh, you're going to ask me. Our show title is We Quintupled Our Net Worth. No, not net worth. Our investment in just 10 easy days using Litecoin.
That sounds like the subject line of a scam spam email, but
it's
true.
Yeah.
We quintupled our investment in 10 days with Litecoin. And we're going to talk a little bit today about cryptocurrencies. We talked about it last week. We're not going to do a whole show on it this week. But basically, the reason we're saying this is if you're new to the Freedom Feens and you're noticing that we are unlike anything on talk radio, and you go, why should I listen to these guys? Wait, that's not really my imitation of our listener. If they're saying, why should I listen to these guys? Well, we quintupled our investment in 5 days legally with 10 days with something you probably don't know anything about, because not a lot of people know about Litecoin. So we're going to talk about it.
Yeah, it's surprising to me. I'll talk to people and they'll be like, but that's like not real money, right? They have the impression that it's like Facebook cash or something you use to buy shoes for your paper dolls on some app.
Yeah, or like it's script from some casino. Well, actually, casino script is worth money, but some government script from back in the day that you can only spend at the company store or something like that.
Yeah.
Nope.
That's not it, although there are some legitimate concerns. I know Peter Schiff is out there
voicing his
poo-pooing of the whole cryptocurrency, but making actual arguments, not just saying, oh, that's what the terrorists use, or oh, that's what drug dealers use.
Money is what terrorists and drug dealers use.
His concerns are that, at some point, the government could clamp down on it far more than they are now, and then where would people be? Another one is, look at Bitcoin. Yeah, it's successful now, but if it's so doable, what's to keep competitors from coming in, taking all the market shares, even though Bitcoin's first, if the market gets so diluted with so many competitors, your value could fall with relation to dollars, your Bitcoin.
Well, I'm surprised the government just hasn't thought of converting that whole NSA spying computer grid facility into a Bitcoin mining operation.
Yes, that was my concern. NSA data center.
That would do more damage to it than any law they could pass. I mean, they can pass laws, but it's like, think about how people are with gold. They're like, you'll get my gold when you pry it out of my cold, dead hands. You know, most people, when gold was outlawed back in the day by benevolent president, which one was it? Well, a few did it.
FDR is who I'm thinking of when he sent out that executive order saying you must surrender all of your gold now, trying to couch it in terms of national security. You can't have this precious metal. The government needs it so we can do our government nasty business.
Yeah. And, some people who were good, upstanding, law-abiding citizens turned in their gold, but most people didn't. Most people had it buried out in the cow pasture, you know? And you can do the same. People can do the same thing with Bitcoin. I'm not suggesting breaking any laws, but again, there's no law against Bitcoin right now. But, what is a law but something that top men write down on paper and then government goons come around and enforce it? And people who say, well, I'm a good law-abiding person, you got to rethink that, because laws are made by man. They're not made by nature. They're not made by God. It's obviously a law of nature that you shouldn't steal and you shouldn't kill, but there's no law of nature that you shouldn't have Bitcoin or gold. I mean, that's just something that men who want to be tax eaters and rent seekers make up.
Yeah, yeah. Some people say there's no such thing as natural law. I think there is, and I think it's different from legislation or edicts or things written down on paper. And I've said before, and I'll say it again, that I think the true function of what courts and lawyers in some kind of libpair or free society would be to discover and try to define as best they can what natural law is. You know, like Newton did with gravity. He didn't invent gravity. He didn't write it down and say, thus far, or from this point forward, things will fall to the ground. No, he noticed something that happened, and he tried to describe it. And I think there are things about human nature and economics that are actual laws. And I think that lawyers and economists should go to great lengths to try to discover those, but realize that they can't just make stuff up out of whole cloth and then have that be the new image the world is cast in.
Yeah, and when you put your faith in a government and in the police that enforce the government with threats of guns to people's head, you know, if you're Christian, you should look at the fact that you're kicking God off the throne. And if you're atheist or agnostic, you should look at the fact that you're making a god out of men, out of the state. I mean, think about how infallible politicians and police are, too. You know, every time you hear some politician with some scandal, I mean, that's just the ones that get caught. They're all like that. Mm-hmm. They're sociopathic. You have to be sociopathic to rise up and become a politician. It is not easy. And right. Even if you're the one pure man holding the lantern in the darkness, you know, once you become a politician, someone's going to offer you a dump truck full of money or threaten you in some way or have pictures of you from back in the day because the NSA is spying on you. And they're going to make you do their bidding anyway. There's no purity in that whole system. And the enforcement arm, police, I mean, this week there have been so many cases of just out of control police, like police holding a woman down and spraying her private parts with mace because they thought she had drugs hidden there to punish her, like torture. That's absolute torture. Think if that was your mother, your daughter, your wife, your grandmother.
Did the Eighth Amendment written down on sheepskin prevent that from happening?
No,
it certainly didn't.
No, and this was in New Mexico, and it's just, I will never set foot in New Mexico. And, you know, I own a little bit of land in New Mexico, and that state is disappointing me so much. I think I'm going to donate that little bit of land to, like, I don't know, the Black Panthers or the Communist Party, or just, I'm going to find out, like, in the county it's in, like, who they would hate the most owning that land and give it to them. Like, even if it's people I would never talk to, I'm going to give them that land just so they can set up a community center, you know, in New Mexico. Because New Mexico is horrible.
I thought you were going to sell it to buy an AK.
No, that was the other bit of, I have some other land there now, too. Yep. Land that is, like, only suitable for a rattlesnake farm that I've never actually visited. New Mexico's a nice place, but my bit of land there isn't. But I think it would make a nice little enclave for some organization, you know, American left-handed lesbian Lithuanian communists from Uganda. Something that I would never support, but, you know, the people in New Mexico would hate even more being there. So I think I'm going to give that land to somebody they would hate, because they've been pulling people over and, like, giving them butt searches because they're just standing around and won't admit they have drugs. And even after they don't find drugs, they take them to the hospital and search their butt again and again. I don't even want to say that on radio. That's not radio friendly, man, but it's the government. So we have to talk about what they're doing on the radio.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And how horrible that they took the first gentleman who came forward with these accusations, they took him to a doctor who said, no way, man, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to perform this invasive, I don't even know what to call it.
It violates the Hippocratic
Oath. Exactly. So then they took him to another hospital with doctors who would be compliant, probably doctors that helped the CIA torture people back in the
Obamacare
day.
Obamacare doctors. It's covered.
Obamacare.
Actually, it's not covered under Obamacare. The guy got a bill for, like, being raped by the doctors, by the police. And they didn't find any drugs, and they did, like, 90s. And there was another one this week that just came out in New Mexico where a woman was in a minor car accident. The police showed up, who were supposed to protect you and serve you and help you when you're in a car accident. And she was non-responsive because she was in a diabetic coma. And they broke the window. They tasered her. They pepper sprayed her. They handcuffed her. And then they kept her from getting medical help while she was in a diabetic coma, man. This is not the exception to the rule anymore. This is the rule. This is what America has become. And, you know, if you sit around saying, well, I'm a law abiding, my guns are, you know, hey, they're going in New York State and California. They are rounding up guns, honestly, legally owned by legal people, like non-criminals, door-to-door confiscations off of the registration rolls. And those are the people who say, I'm a law-abiding citizen. I'm not like those pot smokers. I don't break arbitrary laws. I register my guns.
Yeah, yeah, really horrible. Somebody posted one of these letters. They scanned it and posted it online. And they're sending these out to people in New York City. I guess it's that state law in New York, and maybe New York City even has further restrictions. But they sent it to a guy who has 3 22 rifles.
Grandpa's
saying you must
guns.
Surrender these.
Grandpa's
guns.
Yeah.
Yeah. One of them's bolt action. You must surrender your bolt action 22 because it can hold more than 5 rounds. And it says you must immediately surrender your rifle and or shotgun to your local police precinct and notify the office of the invoice number. Basically outlining all of these things that you have to do now so that they don't come raid you with a SWAT team like they're doing in California to people who fall under the prohibited persons category.
Yeah, and one of the comments I really liked was, yes, a bolt action is a weapon of mass destruction if you're a squirrel. I'd like you to read this rather long quote from founding father James Madison. And we don't rely on the founding fathers and deify them. And, you know, like Lysander Spooner says, it's either the Constitution has either been powerless to protect us or it was set up to do all this. But, you know, James Madison was kind of one of the good ones. And read what he said about supporting, you know, your armies and your police.
Okay, I guess I have to do it in 30 Pigeon. Seconds. Of all the enemies to public liberty, war is perhaps the most to be dreaded because it comprises and develops the germ of every other. War is the parent of armies. From these proceed debts and taxes, and armies and debts and taxes are the known instrument for bringing the many under the domination of the few. In war, too, the discretionary power of the executive is extended. Its influence in dealing out offices, honors, and emoluments is multiplied, and all the means of seducing the minds are added to those of subduing the force of the people. The same malignant aspect in republicanism may be traced in the inequality of fortunes and the opportunities of fraud growing out of a constant state of war, and in the degeneration of manners and morals endangered by both. No nation could preserve its freedom in the midst of continual warfare, and we will be back on the Freedom Feens Live Talk Radio Show.
You're listening to Freedom Feens with Nima V and Michael Dean. They'll be right back just as soon as this drone is out of range.
This is Nima Vedati from the Freedom Feens. Using government-printed funny money fuels and encourages wars abroad, and the wars at home against you and all you hold dear. Why should you remain beholden to self-appointed federal kings who don't care if you starve in a cage? Become your own king today by owning gold and silver from Midas Resources. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the Midas Resources banner over on the right, or go to gold.freedomfiends.com. That's gold.freedomfiends.com.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Feens now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed, buy sheep for sheep on sheep, and 2 designs for the Freedom Feens. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists.
It's only $10 for 10 buttons, including shipping.
Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says Buttons.
Hey, this is Squisklar Squigelps from Death Clocks. And you are listening to the Freedom Feens on the, you know, the radios. And I guess it says worms now. So there you go.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
I All right, everybody. It's the Freedom Feens live talk radio show. And that is exactly what it means. We are live. It is November 30th, Gold Saturday, as we like to call it. I am Nima Vedati. We've also got Michael W. Dean out there. Are you in the driver's seat of the Wormabago right now, or are you in the back room studio of it?
I'm in the sub-basement of the Wormabago, actually.
Sub-basement of the Wormabago. Okay. Okay.
Yep.
Excellent.
And we
I didn't know Wormabagos could have sub-basements.
We are live. Well, it goes into the 11th dimension. This multiverse goes to 11. It is November 30th, Saturday. We are live, unlike most talk shows that...
We don't usually give out the date anymore, but we figured we might as well just to prove
it. We want to prove it. Yes, I will read from the newspaper to prove proof of life of the Freedom Feens here. And we don't take days off on the Freedom Feens. Nima takes days off, but I don't. I will...
Newspaper? They put news on paper now?
Newspaper?
What's that?
It's like the internet on crushed up trees, Grandpa. Sunny. Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah. Yep. So before the break, we were talking about Bitcoin, and somehow we got off onto a rant where Nima sounded like he was committing sedition, but he was actually just quoting founding father James Madison. And like we've said, we like some of those guys. We don't collectivize them. We don't say, well, the founding fathers were great, because some of them were skunks, man.
Yeah. Like Alexander Hamilton.
Hamilton was, the reason we have a Federal Reserve, and he wanted a huge federal government. He didn't want the experiment of many laboratories of liberty to work at all.
He thought public debt was a good thing. He's kind of like a proto-Keynesian. He thought that you need to have public debt so that you can fund all the big corporate interests and make sure that the economy runs smoothly yet is controlled by the powers that already be, of which he was one, which is why he was a proponent of such a thing.
Yeah, that's the broken windows fallacy, which, apparently worked, was driving those drug cops in Denver recently who thought if they broke the windows of small business owners – it would help the economy. The small business owners.
It's kind of more sinister than that, because maybe they even knew the story of the broken window fallacy. They just figured, well, if we're the ones breaking the windows and the ones who own the window shop, then who cares if the other people lose money? Who cares if it's a net loss? If we're the ones getting any gains there are to be got, then good for us.
Yeah, and Lou Sander Fien, who lives in Detroit, one of our favorite fiends, he and I made a great meme that said it was a picture of a factory in Detroit, abandoned factory, where every window, like hundreds of windows, were broken. And it said, if broken windows cause prosperity, the streets of Detroit would be paved in gold.
Instead, they're paved in broken glass because nobody can afford to fix the windows anymore.
So we're talking about Bitcoin. People don't know what Bitcoin is, you may have been hearing these words a lot. It's basically a synthetic money that doesn't go through any government or corporate infrastructure. And people like Glenn Beck say, well, that's horrible. That's going to destroy America. But that doesn't make sense, because Glenn Beck also says we need to get rid of the Federal Reserve and everyone should have gold. And it's like, Bitcoin has advantages over gold, but gold has advantages over Bitcoin. And when we say Bitcoin, we're speaking of all cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin, Litecoin, PP coin, which is not what it sounds like, and there's a few others. But basically, they are decentralized, pseudo-anonymous ways of sending what people consider money, because it does have value and you can buy and sell it, and you can buy and sell things with it. So it has value. And it has gone up. I mean, it was like 10 cents a few years ago for one Bitcoin, and now it's like $1,100 for one Bitcoin. And we have some friends that are kicking themselves in the head for it. I had 3 Bitcoin, the Fiends had 3 Bitcoin, and I lost the password. So we had to start a new wallet, and that was donated to us, and it'd be now worth about $3,300. Our friend Stephanie Murphy, a few years ago, when Bitcoin was $10, cashed out part of an IRA and was going to buy 500 Bitcoin for $5,000, but paid off credit card debts instead. And I asked her if I could say this by name on the air, and she said, yeah. I mean, that, in 2 years, that would have gone from $5,000 to $500,000, and she didn't do it. She paid off her debt instead. there's a guy in England who threw away a hard drive that he forgot had a bunch of Bitcoin on it, because he bought them when they were pennies each. And what is it worth? Like $7 million, and it's under a giant pile of trash in London right now, under tons of trash, and they've sent out they're spending a lot of money sending out the British military to guard this pile of trash now because people want to go in and try to find that hard drive. Yeah.
Now, some people are saying, well, one of the things about Bitcoin that they don't like, this is what Peter Schiff said, and I think we should address it, is that Schiff. Bitcoin doesn't have intrinsic value, right? Like gold, people will use it in electronics. People like the jewelry. People want gold on their person, in their homes. We'll go over some Aristotle rules
for
money.
Federal Reserve notes don't have intrinsic value.
Exactly. They don't either, but he's not a fan of those either. But we'll be back with some more thoughts on that question in just a little bit.
Worms.
Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. Basic Handgun and Rifle with Jared Waltz.
First rule of being alive is you own yourself.
A groundbreaking approach to firearms and self-defense training. Beautifully filmed and easy to understand instructions make this one a must-have. Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. New DVD from Michael W. Dean, available on Amazon.
Your house is your property.
Welcome back to the Freedom Feens recorded radio show, coming to you from reel-to-reel tape recorded over electron tubes and ribbon microphones. I am Nima Vadati. We've also got Michael W. Dean. How are you doing today?
It's not recorded. It's live. I have proof of life. Today is November 30th in the year of our Lord, 2013.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. You were talking about the good old days, you know, the days of polio, segregation, and gas rationing.
Yeah, which, you know, we kind of make fun of that. Ben Stone and I did a podcast yesterday just to do some sound checking. It's like a 12-minute thing. If you go to badquaker.com, it's basically he and I are like in our 50s, and Nima's a youngster of 30. So we kind of make jokes about us being old.
Not like, 30 yet. I'm not claiming it till it's actually proven.
Yeah.
Still 29.
But we kind of did an alter ego 12-minute episode of Ben and I sounding like old people. And we got nothing against old people. What kind of bothers me is when they vote. No, what kind of bothers me is like when people try to cling to what they considered the greatness of the past and try to enforce laws to keep things that way. Like this America of the mind that never really existed. When people say, I want to go back to when America was great. And I say, which part? Polio, segregation, or gas rationing stamps? And I mean, I've been through a lot of technological change in my lifetime. I've recorded records on that were put out on vinyl and recorded them on 24-track, 2-inch tape. And I don't long for that at all. I mean, we could do that all on our computers now, much cheaper. I mean, you had to buy tape. You had to rent time in a studio. You had to, like, put it out on vinyl and press it and send it around the world in trucks, you know? And
how awful thinking that you don't have unlimited data that you can record. And,
yeah.
And you have to get this take right or we're out of tape and we have to go buy more.
Well, you could go over the tape 2 or 3 times, but it actually – the sound quality degraded after a while. So you really had to get the takes – you know, when you could get them. And when people, I don't have a problem with nostalgia. I don't have a problem with talking about the good old days. I have a problem with people who want to pass laws, which means government guns being in, you know, cops, people who rape people at traffic stops, basically. I mean, that's been happening a lot lately, especially in New Mexico. You know, people whose whole job monopoly is enforced by bad laws, by bad actions, by non-voluntary interactions. You know, I have a problem with people who want to freeze America in some memory that basically is back when there was segregation and polio, and they're trying to create a Christian Saudi Arabia. And I love Christians. Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, is one of my best friends. He's a Christian. The Freedom Fiends are the guys who are like, yeah, we're kind of like, I mean, I'm a deist, which is what Thomas Jefferson was. So before you dismiss it, if you love the America of the mind that includes Thomas Jefferson, I'm the same religion as him. I'm a deist. I absolutely believe there's a God that created everything, but I don't believe that it, you know, that it muddles around in your day-to-day life and keeps, you know, keeps your child from dying. My child died of cancer. No amount of prayer saved that from happening. And, you know, I don't believe that prayer makes the bus come on time. I think that there is a vast force that created the universe. I call it God, but I don't think that it intervenes in the day-to-day life of people. So that's what a deist is. That's me. But I'm a deist who will fight to the death for your right to have religious freedom. You know, I don't want anyone to stop anyone from worshiping the way they want to. But a lot of times people try to use laws to make their idea of a religious paradise enacted. You know, things like outlawing looking at the ladies' underwear catalog or smoking some kind of weed or something, or forcing prayer in schools or forcing the Pledge of Allegiance in schools. You know, this kind of America, like Saudi Arabian America idea. I don't like that.
Well, it seems so antithetical to, I mean, if you are a Christian, it seems very antithetical to what Jesus was really about, right? I mean, when the mob brought him the prostitute and said, "We caught her, you know, and enabling adultery," he basically said, "Well, let her go. It's not your job. Men don't get to make these calls. My father will," you know, yeah. that kind of a thing. And I think in that story is basically the Bible saying that men don't get to institute morality laws. They don't get to impose their own moral edicts on other men because they're not perfect. They're fallible. They have the original sin. The only person who gets to do that is God. Or if you're not a theist, then, you know, I say natural law. And I said that before. And here's sort of my example is the law of supply and demand and various other economic laws, as the Misesians point out. These are things that happen no matter what. There's no government edict that will prevent people who want things from finding a way to buy them, because there will always be people who notice the demand and figure out a way to supply them. That is immutable.
Yeah, the war on drugs breeds drugs, literally. Like, there are way more drugs, way stronger, way more available than there were before the war on drugs. And it's because when you have a war on drugs, the, you know, people who are like mafioso type want to get involved because there's such a high return rate. And they stop doing things like, you know, smuggling in a ton of marijuana when they can smuggle in, you know, a briefcase of some white powder. You know, you end up with stronger, right, cheaper, more powerful, more dangerous drugs. And you end up with things like you have now in Mexico where, you know, they're more the cartels are more militarized than the military. They're executing, right, citizens and cutting their heads off and putting them in the town square. And they're doing things like getting involved in much bigger business, like taking over iron ore mines. You know, it used to, right, be the cartels were like sending Winnebagos across the border full of drugs. Now they're sending, you know, they're murdering people to take control of things, where they're sending, like, you know, 50 shipping containers of iron ore to China. You know, so if you think buy American, support American, you're supporting China and Mexican cartels by enforcing and being behind laws against drugs.
Right, right. And the prohibition of the drug trade is what allowed these people who don't want to follow any laws, who use violence as their main method of gaining competitive advantage, they're the ones who become successful in the drug trade. And then, yes, they can turn their sights on things like mining operations and do it completely immorally through violence, take over the mines and shoot the people that come out to see what's going on. And this is completely result of the prohibition, because if there wasn't a prohibition on this, then legitimate people, businessmen who had to follow some kind of scruples, would be more successful because they would have a reputation to uphold in the market.
So we were talking about Bitcoin. Bitcoin's been called the honey badger of money. How is Bitcoin different than the war on drugs?
Ah, yes. Well, because Bitcoin is kind of a savior. It's decentralized. It's not a human edict. It's actually drawing on the decentralized power of human action, i.e. the market, i.e. The natural economic laws that guide and organize the world, even in spite of government interventions and ruination and wrecking, as I guess the Soviets would call it. And I guess I kind of wanted to go through, because I think people do have a legitimate claim that you know, Bitcoin doesn't have intrinsic value like gold. I will grant that. But there are, according to Aristotle, four things that make money good. And let's go through these and figure out where Bitcoin sort of lies on the spectrum. Because I think it actually does the first three better than anything else that has been out there used widely as currency thus far. Number one is it must be durable. Money must stand the test of time and the elements. It must not fade, corrode, or change through time. Well, maybe not that one, because I know that you you had some Bitcoin that are no longer existent. But I think for the most part, if you take care, Bitcoins don't go away, right? I mean, your Bitcoins don't get tarnished. The number chain doesn't get corrupted, does it,
they
as
can't,
far as I know?
They cannot get eaten by rats. In that movie, Bad Boys 2, there's a drug dealer who's got so much money. Okay, this is a total rich guy problem. He's got a room full of American dollars in his Mexican hideout. It's being eaten by rats. He's got so much money that rats are eating his money. Yeah, that doesn't happen with Bitcoin.
Yeah. I mean, and Bitcoin, you know, you could back it up.
Back it up.
That kind of thing.
Peep.
I don't know. Maybe gold and Bitcoin are a tie on this. Because gold, if you keep it in your safe, it's going to be fine. You can melt it down and do other things with it. But you could lose gold too.
You could lose any money. You could lose any money. And, you know, mm-hmm. You could say, well, you don't lose money that's in a bank that's, you know, electronic numbers somewhere on your credit card. But those banks could fail, or more likely sooner, they could just take it like they have in some Middle Eastern the European country. What was it? Cyprus, where the government just said, we're taking 10% of the money that everyone has in the bank because the government needs it. Or they can freeze your accounts. That cannot be done with Bitcoin. And they do that all the time to punish people that disagree with the government or are doing something the government doesn't like. They just freeze your accounts. Right. They just make your money
disappear. And now, didn't that happen with PayPal too?
Yeah.
Because some people say, well, what about PayPal? But they froze Sheriff Mack's account, didn't they?
Yeah, and I never leave more than about $100 in PayPal. When we get donations, we basically cash it out and spend it. And the Freedom Feens do take donations, and we put it back into our Liberty Projects. You can go to freedomfiends.com. That's Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, Echo, November, Sierra. We take donations in Bitcoin, Litecoin, and PayPal and U.S. dollars. And we also sell buttons. They make a great Christmas gift. It's 10 buttons for $10. So go check that out.
All right, let's move on to number two in Aristotle's list of what makes good money. It must be portable. Money hold a high amount of worth relative to its weight and size. Now, I think this is one of the ways Bitcoin just demolishes the competition. Bitcoin is so portable. I mean, it can go around the world with such small transaction cost. You know, we're talking you could transfer millions of dollars worth of Bitcoin and pay pennies, if that, on the transaction.
Yeah. And that goes on to number three. Good money must be divisible, which Bitcoin is more divisible than any other form of money. It can be divided to like the millionth place, you know, a millionth.
And apparently the smallest unit is named after the guy who sort of was the theorist behind
Satoshi.
Bitcoin. The smallest unit is called a Satoshi.
Yes.
I think this is another great thing about Bitcoin, where it does blow all the other competitors out of the water thus far that have gained popularity amongst human traders. Four, it must have intrinsic value. I would say gold can probably beat Bitcoin on that. Yeah,
definitely.
You got me.
Definitely. However, Bitcoin is representative of work, unlike Federal Reserve notes. It takes computing power and electricity and a lot of it to mine Bitcoin. So that would kind of satisfy with like socialists who say, well, things are worth
theory of value.
The labor theory, like things are worth the amount of work you put into them. Like Bitcoin's at least worth that. But yeah,
which is that's a fallacy. So I don't know if we could use that. But I get your point. It does have scarcity built into it. I guess that's not here on the list, but hey, it's something. And we'll go more into number four and some things that Bitcoin does have intrinsic value. We'll be back from the market in just a bit.
Worms.
You're listening to Freedom Feens, not your grandpa's talk radio. This is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends. Federal Reserve notes only have value because of a collective hallucination, whereas gold and silver are real, and so is their value. Gold and silver predate government-printed funny money, and they will undoubtedly outlive government-printed funny money. Get some gold and silver into your hands from Midas Resources by going to freedomfiends.com right now and clicking on the Midas Resources banner over on the right. Or go to gold.freedomfiends.com. That's gold.freedomfiends.com.
Creamy Radio Audio. Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Fiends has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message. With articles on microphones, preamps, recorders, mastering, recording remotely over the internet, doing a podcast, even getting a show on actual radio, the Freedom Fiends show you what they use and where to get it. Whether you're a talk show host, voiceover artist, podcaster, evangelist, or just want to record your loved ones for the ages, at Creamy Radio Audio, the Freedom Fiends will help you make the most of your sound. Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the Fiends will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
The Electronic Frontier Foundation, or EFF, fights to protect your rights in the digital world. When a patent troll threatened podcasters, they fought back. EFF has also defended your right to encryption and has sued the NSA to end the government's mass, suspicionless surveillance. There are different ways you can help EFF, from donations, to signing petitions, to writing your representatives, to just spreading the word. Find out more at EFF.org. That's EFF.org.
Okay, it's the Freedom Fiends Live Talk Radio Show. Thanks for sticking with us. We're at the bottom of hour one. I'm Nima Vidati out here in Central Texas. We've also got Michael W. Dean in the Wormabago. How's it going, Mr. Dean?
Good. I'm out here in my windowless mobile bunker in Beast Lick, Wyoming, and we are live, and we're going to be taking phone calls in the second hour of the Freedom Fiends here on November 30th. But we're talking about Bitcoin, and people are like, what's Bitcoin? Why should I care? Here's why you should care. And it may not affect you directly right now, but Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies in general are basically right now where the internet was in 1994. And in 1994, I was on the internet and I was telling everyone I knew, you should be on the internet. You should check this out. And they were like, internet? What's that? And in 1990, right. You know, and most people didn't get on it until, when did you get on the internet? You're younger, but.
Oh, I don't know. I guess 1997,
yeah.
1998, yeah. Maybe, something like that. Yeah.
Yep. But, you know, people were like, I don't need the internet. I have the telephone. I have the radio. I have the books and the magazines. And the internet is basically the most important technology change in my lifetime, in the 40 years I've been alive. And
definitely.
And it's largely been built by people and individuals. You know, the government likes to say, Al Gore likes to say he invented it. The government invented it. But
look at Obamacare's website.
Yeah, look at Obamacare's website. Itself. Yeah, and if you want to go to the free market, you know, go to Amazon. But get there through the Freedom Fiends link on freedomfiends.com. And if you want gold, go to Midas Resources through the link on freedomfiends.com. Gold, silver, or palladium. Yes. Yeah.
And now gold definitely does womp Bitcoin in the intrinsic value category of Aristotle's definition of what makes good money. But do you think Bitcoin has any intrinsic value is the question I want to pose to you and also to the listeners as a whole for when we come back in hour two to take calls. Michael, what do you think Bitcoin, does it have anything that makes it worthwhile other than being a great source of durability and transportability and divisibility?
Yeah, the fact that people are using it for transactions. People don't generally use gold for transactions. I mean, the government does when they bribe some Saudi prince chance to like be nicer in what they say about him on Fox News or whatever, probably.
Well, but people make that same argument about government money, and that does beat Bitcoin because people still use it more. That's still, I think, in the first three categories.
Yeah, but I mean, I go back to Bitcoin is where the internet was in 1994. In 1994, not many people were on the internet. It was hard to get on it. There wasn't much there. And, you know, you'd go on it, you'd go, oh, nice, a picture, a low-res picture of a cat. Neat, you know? And now you can do everything.
Are you saying it can gain more intrinsic? I mean, if the value is intrinsic, yeah, then it has it or it doesn't.
Well, the more people that use it, the more people that use it, and especially use it in transactions rather than just hoard it, the more value it's going to have. And actually, like Subway sub shops are taking Bitcoin now. That's, and, you know,
still not intrinsic value, but
I see what you mean. Like, you know, like usefulness for, well, it has usefulness for things other than money. We talked last week about how it can be used for like proof of authorship of a certain date to replace copyright, to replace, you know, registering something with the courts or with the government or, you know, for trademark, basically eliminating the need for government controlled trademark, things like that. That's an intrinsic value, I'd say.
Okay. Yeah, I could see that. Molyneux's argument is that, yeah, the architecture of it and the fact that it can do these other things is at least some sense of intrinsic value. So yeah, maybe.
You know, go back to like what was the intrinsic value of the internet in 1994? You know, it had like less than 1% as many people on it as it has now, like 1/10 of as many people. There was hardly any content on it. It was slow. It was dial-up over a modem. It cost a lot. You had to pay by minute with AOL even to use it.
Whereas now its value is the fact that you have a device in your pocket that can access pretty much every word ever written or spoken in the known universe.
Yeah, and you can do, you know, things like radio from home because the bandwidth has gotten down. And you can, you know, these days, like if I want to hear a song, I just search the song title on YouTube and somebody's put the song on YouTube and they figured out a way to make money on it. They put ads on it, you know, so like the copyright holders are happy. So it even morphs with the old world technology of government controlled copyrights.
Yeah. Well, you don't even have to know the name of the song. I mean, often I'll hear one lyric or one word or two, three words, and that's all it takes. I put it in my Google as, you know, a computer kill Flanders type search, and somebody will have it on Yahoo Answers, somebody previous to me asking the question, and somebody say, oh, that's blah, 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 by blah, 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 and then I'll be able to download it. So quick, so easy. That's an immensely valuable thing. Does that count as intrinsic value? I guess I would say so.
Yeah.
So we'll be back with more discussion, and we will also be back to take your calls in hour two. So stick with us through this trip to the market, and it is Gold Saturday, so be sure to get out there and engage in as much commerce as you feel like. We'll be back on the Freedom Feens.
This is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends. I've been on the World Wide Web since its inception in 1994. I've tried dozens of web providers in that time. The only one that hasn't broken my heart is HostGator. HostGator has unlimited server space, unlimited throughput, and a guaranteed uptime of better than 99.9% for only $150 a year. You can pay a little less elsewhere, but you'll pull out your hair dealing with anyone else. HostGator has great service and unlimited tech support, only a phone call away, 24/7, 365. HostGator is where pros like the Fiends host, because we know how to do it right. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the HostGator affiliate link on the right sidebar to sign up today.
All right, it's the Freedom Fiends Live Talk Radio Show. Thank you so much for joining us. I am Nima Vedati here in Central Texas, the Hill Country. Thank the Lord it is back up to 60-something degrees. I'm sick of all those cloudy, rainy, 50-degree days. We've also got Michael W. Dean out there in the wilds of Wyoming where it's negative 200. Celsius is approaching
Kelvin,
absolute zero.
Kelvin. Negative 2. Yeah, this is Michael Dean broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker at an undisclosed location in the rural wild mountain west in the occupied states of America. Today I'm in Beast Lick, Wyoming. by beautiful Beast Lake, Wyoming. So
yes, and if you want to join us through the magic of the interwebs, you can call actually at 1-855-660-4261. I guess it's a phone line, but maybe you have a phone provided through your cable company and it's actually VoIP, and then it is the magic of the interwebs. So call 1-855-660-4261 if you want to chat with us about Bitcoin. Does it have intrinsic value or not? Who knows?
And, you know, we don't just – when we take calls, the amount of time we keep you on ain't just whether or not you agree with us or not. It's about how good your sound quality is. So if you're calling over the internet phones, we're probably not going to keep you on very long. But if you're calling over – we're going to start taking Skype calls here pretty soon. And you should go to the Freedom Feens blog and check out the recommendation I have for a microphone. It's $100 that works amazing over Skype. And it's, you know, we have about $5,000 worth of equipment to do this show, but this $100 mic sounds about 85% as good as our $5,000 worth of equipment. So,
and it's easier. It's plug and play. You don't have to sit there and tweak the settings all morning like I had to do.
Yep. All you need is this thing and a pair of cheap headphones and you'll sound really good. And when you call the Feens upcoming in the future, when we take, Skype phone calls, we'll keep you on longer, even if we disagree with you, because you'll sound so good.
Yeah, so creamy.
Yep. So today is Gold Saturday, which is what the Freedom Feens have dubbed the day after Black Friday and the 2 days after Gray Thursday. Gold Friday is our day of go out and buy some stuff in the free market and not outside the government coerced so-called free market that isn't free. And we're going to talk about that more. The free market, you can use Bitcoin, you can use cash, you can use gold, you can buy some gold on Gold Saturday. But there's this thing now called Gray Thursday, which is what they're calling. Retailers have extended Black Friday, the day after Thanksgiving, the biggest retail day of the year, back a day to Thanksgiving. They're actually having sales and being open, a lot of them, on Thanksgiving. And I heard Fox News pundits talking about how this is a plot to destroy the American family. That is so ridiculous, man.
Who would be plotting that?
Obama. I mean,
that doesn't make any sense. Yeah. Obama. The government agencies are the only people I can think of, and I don't think they take too kindly to retailers making a lot of money. I don't know. Maybe they do. But it just doesn't seem – it seems like a non sequitur to me.
What's Obama done to you today, Nima?
Probably lots of things. Too many things to count. Which one should we talk about?
Well, I wanted to get into this thing about what all these right-wing sites are saying. Look what Obama's Federal Trade Commission is doing. But, you know, Obama owns it and could stop it. But this sounds more like George Bush was really into this kind of stuff. And those two guys have done more to destroy the lives of Americans and people around the world than any other two presidents since. Okay, I'm going to say it, and it's going to require explanation. Abe Lincoln killed more Americans than Hitler. What does that mean, Nima? That sounds like I didn't
exactly
want
exactly what it sounds
but,
like.
Do you want slavery? You must like slavery.
No, but Lincoln's anti-slavery stance was nothing but a military tactic that he came up with after the fact in order to punish the Southern military machine. It really was a tangential thing and was used as an after-the-fact justification in history books by hagiographers. And one thing we could point to that I like to point to is his inaugural address, where he said a lot of racist things about black people and said that he wanted to leave slavery alone. He also talked about how if he did ever get rid of slavery, he still didn't think the races should mix. He was very adamant about that, even going so far as to I guess none of these plots ever worked out. But he was a proponent of recolonization, i.e. sending ethnic Africans back to Africa, because he didn't think that this subservient race, as he would have seen them, should exist on the same space-time as those good white folks that he liked.
Abraham Lincoln sounds like a horrible man, but Nima, without Abraham Lincoln, slavery would not have ended. Isn't that true?
No, because there was no Abraham Lincoln in any of the other places around the world that ended slavery. It was the meme theory that we like to talk about that ended slavery. It got around through humanity, through language, through the viral movement of thoughts that slavery was an awful thing, that it was an inhumane institution, and that it was unnecessary. Technology also helped to prove the people who were making the practical argument wrong in the fact that you know, automation methods and ways of harvesting crops became a lot easier to do. They were less labor intensive. So a number of factors helped to end slavery, but I would not credit political action with any of it.
So jumping forward to what Obama's done to you today, first I want to talk about International Buy Nothing Day, which is a day of protest against consumerism. It's held on the Friday and Black Friday, the day after Thanksgiving in America, and it was organized by Vancouver artist Ted Dave and subsequently promoted in Adbusters magazine. So basically, it's a communist holiday or a socialist holiday or an anti-consumerist holiday, and not everyone in Canada thinks like this guy does, because tomorrow, who do we have?
Oh, we have Ed and Ethan. Yeah, I guess we should talk about that. I'm going to be taking a pseudo leave of absence for paternity. My daughter is on the way any time now. My wife is full term. And so my firstborn child will be arriving soon. And I want to make sure I have a little bit more time than I have on my hands now to spend with her, because obviously the initial days, weeks, and years are the most important.
Yeah, and it's only for 2 months, and you're still going to be here on Saturdays and our Wednesday podcast non-radio show.
For the most part.
You're taking Sundays off, and we have some stellar you can't replace Nima, but we have some stellar fill-ins lined up. And Ed Ethan, who are some real free market guys from Canada, are going to come on and tell you about how wonderful healthcare – no, how horrible government-controlled healthcare works out tomorrow.
Yeah,
so International Buy Nothing Day is this thing that, you know, basically a bunch of people with no money say, we won't buy anything on this day. We'll wreck the economy. And it really doesn't do anything, because
we'll pat ourselves on the back for doing what we normally do, not being able to buy anything.
And Lou pointed out, you know, North Korea has Buy Nothing Day every day. And look how it's worked out for them. And we do believe in commerce. Commerce as a not like a panacea, save all, savior of everything, but you know, when libertarians are asked, well, who would do this without the government, we usually say the market or the free market. And people, they act like you're saying magical fairy dust would fix everything, but the market is just the unencumbered transmission of value for goods, and both people win, and it's voluntary. One person wants something, the other person has something, the other person has something that's worth more to them, they trade, whether it's money or cash or goods or Bitcoin or services or sex, drugs, and rock and roll. People trade stuff. All governments do. They don't add any value. They just interfere with interstate and international commerce. They just come in, take a cut, and pass laws that don't help anybody. That's all they do.
And if there's not something wrong with it, if there's something you're upset about, then it's not the voluntary transaction that you're upset about. I did this during Thanksgiving. I tried to press some people who were anti-consumerist on, well, what's so wrong with commerce? And they brought up things that have nothing to do with voluntary trade or transaction. They brought up things like, well, you know, some companies use slave labor. Some Chinese companies, you know, it's very slavery-like, and they don't pay good wages. And I guess the answer to that is, well, that's a company by company basis. You know, if you don't like that kind of a company, there's nothing to make you buy their products. Seek out and find somebody to do commerce with that you like. But some kind of universal hatred of voluntary exchange, that's just bad. And that's just a bad idea. It doesn't make any sense. And these people don't universalize it. I mean, do they feel dirty when they buy food from the grocery store? And if they don't use grocery stores, do they feel dirty when they buy it from the farmer's market?
You know, I would say, my only complaint about consumerism, other than that, my huge complaint that it's not a truly free market because the government always has their fingers up some entry of it. My main problem with it is that there's so much crap out there, which isn't, I don't have anything against it, but it's kind of like crap gets pushed out, good things get pushed out in favor of crap. And there's a really good comment from Max Kaiser about that. He said, Bitcoin hoarders will spend their Bitcoin when something worth buying comes along. Fiat money has bred bad products.
Ah, that's a really great point. And maybe that's one of the most beautiful things I've heard said about Bitcoin. Jeffrey Tucker was on it too, is that because the value of your Bitcoin seems to be going up, up, and up, you know, that seems to be the trend. The opposite is true of government fiat money, as they seem to be keep going down, down, and down in value. There's an inflationary sense about them. And that makes people want to buy things, because why would they save their Federal Reserve notes when they're going to be less in the future, when they could buy a good right now that they might like?
That's been my idea. I'm I'm putting money into a house. My wife and I are putting money into a house, and basically, I've become an extreme consumerist, not extreme consumerist, but just like if mostly stuff for doing radio. If there's some piece of gear I see, I buy it today. I don't buy it on a credit card. I buy it with money, with Federal Reserve notes, because I don't have credit cards. I got rid of them, and I didn't even need Dave Ramsey. It's like the only debt we have is our mortgage, and we don't have a lot in savings. We have enough to cover like an emergency if it comes up, but we have no credit cards. We have debit cards, but we do not have, Dave thing on our own. We don't need some radio guy to tell us that.
But if the most used means of transaction is government money, which is inflationary, i.e. the value is constantly going down with regard to real goods, you're going to want to dump it into something else. You're either going to want to invest it, and there's not enough people that know enough about the stock market. They're kind of forced into it, or you're going to want to spend it because that's your incentive. You might as well buy now than wait later when the price of a lot of things is going to go up. I mean, why are you going to wait to buy food when you know that the price of food could go up?
Yeah, and so speaking of International Buy Nothing Day and the way that communists and socialists and fascists who want to have government manipulation of markets to make everyone suffer work, let's read about what Obama's done to you today. Obama's Federal Trade Commission and their war on piano teachers. This just made me so angry, man. I couldn't believe this, but this is the government in action. And, you know, Bush really ramped this agency up. It's Bush and Obama. They took away your freedoms. And a lot of these people who that were harmed with this probably voted for Obama. So go on.
Yes. Well, basically, and this is completely horrible, like you say, the FTC is going after piano teachers for, quote, anti-competitive issues. They think that they are going to come in and make the transactions friendlier, but they're going to impose all sorts of horrible things. We'll have more details for you when we get back from this trip to the market.
Worms.
You're listening to Freedom Feens with Nima V and Michael Dean, tasing you with liberty since 2011. Learn more at freedomfiends.com.
Want to contribute to liberty but short on cash? You can help the Freedom Feens without even spending a post-1964 dime. Download uTorrent and start seeding Fiends episodes and DVDs to help keep us drone-proof. There's a Torrent Club link at the top of freedomfiends.com. There you'll find our Torrent RSS feed and instructions to grab past episodes and automatically download new ones, even while you're away from the computer. You'll also get special episodes of The Fiends days or even weeks before regular podcast subscribers who aren't torrenting. Leave your computer on, seeding the torrents while you're at work or asleep. The more people seeding The Fiends, the more drone-proof we'll be when the boot comes down.
Yeah, it's the Freedom Feens live talk radio show. I am Nima Vidati out here in the Texas Hill Country. We've also got Michael W. Dean out there in the Great Plains of Wyoming rolling around in that wormmobile. How's it going?
It's going good. And we were talking about government socialism and how, yes, Obama is one of them, but so was George Bush. And he put in a lot of laws that really bred horrible things. You know, one was his No Child Left Behind, Bush's legacy, his Obamacare, basically. Well, the war, killing all those people over in the Middle East was also his, that didn't actually have the weapons of mass destruction. But hey, you know, we went on the information we had that was handed to us by Dick Cheney's people. Yeah, so. So yeah, George Bush did some horrible things. He did No Child Left Behind, which has morphed into what's the thing called? Clear Control.
Common Core. Hold and Build. Common Core. Yeah. Trying to standardize the curriculum and the textbooks that everybody in the whole
nation. It's basically standardizing it to make it anti Bill of Rights and also just standardizing mistakes. It's got a lot of typos in it, man, and just a lot of like overly long lessons and then like overly short lessons and like things don't jive and it doesn't work out, man. So that's what government control does. We're in the free market, you know. Government control is the Obamacare website. Freedom, the free market is Amazon. Which one works better when you go to try to do something? You know, so
well. Here's the thing: is that whenever you have government control of an economy, and your anti-consumers will say things like this too, is like people don't need all these choices. I use one type of soap. Everybody should just use one type of soap. Well, when you have one type of anything, first of all, that's a good example. Is what you had in the Soviet Union.
I've been to the Communism Museum in Prague, and anybody who thinks that one type of thing is good should visit the Museum of Communism in Prague, which is basically they've kept, you know, the back when things were like this, and it's all a museum, and it's actually like it was. And like, oh, you want to see the food? It basically says food on a can, and it's got like lead poisoning in it. That's what you get. Here's Obama's war on grandmas. Obama and Bush. So basically this year they sent out, the Federal Trade Commission sent out lawyer letters, nasty grams, to this organization of music teachers called MTNA, which is Music Teachers National Association, and basically sent them letters saying that they were engaged in anti-competitive behavior because they had it in their bylaws, which are not like enforced. It's suggestions. They're suggestions for members. They had that you shouldn't poach students from other piano teachers who are members. That is not anti-competitive. That is like every industry in the world has that unwritten. Like doctors don't try to poach patients from other doctors. Lawyers don't do it from other lawyers. You know, mechanics don't do it from other mechanics. It's considered bad form to do that. And they put it in writing as a suggestion. The Federal Trade Commission, who are supposed to be people who go after like, you know, U.S. Steel when they're being a cartel with some other steel organization, are going after these grandmas and moms who like, you know, teach piano to kids in the neighborhood for you know, lunch money, basically, after class, and telling them, A, they have to take this out of their bylaws, and B, they have to send a printed mailed letter at their expense, in the mail, not emailed, out to every one of their 300,000 members. They have to have a compliance person. Originally, the FTC said it had to be an attorney, and they said they couldn't afford it. And they said, well, it can be a non-attorney, but we need someone to like regularly send us reports filled out on government forms to prove that you're not engaging in this anti-competitive behavior anymore. That's the government just getting in the way. They're doing this more and more and more and more. And they're like,
and this organization's a non-profit organization.
Yeah.
How's that for you? The Federal Trade Commission is cracking down on a non-profit.
Of grandmas. Yep, basically.
So, yeah, and just awful. And I have no problem. I mean, here's...
Yeah. So I don't have any problem with that, with people having competition at all. I think that it's a good thing. It's good for America. And, you know, why try to control people when they're doing something that isn't harming anybody? Let me read a little bit more of this. It was bizarre, given that the MTNA has existed since 1876, solely existed to advance the cause of music study and support music teachers. The 501c3 has about 22,000 members. Nearly 90% of them are piano teachers, including many women who earn a modest living giving lessons in their homes. The association's sin, according to the feds, rested in its code of ethics. The code lays out the ideals for members to follow, a commitment to students, colleagues, and society. Tucked away in this worthy document was a provision calling on teachers to respect their colleagues' studios and not actively recruit students from other teachers. And we'll have more when we come back from the free market, from the real free market, not the government-controlled free market that is a war on grandmas and everybody. On the Freedom Fiends, Worms.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends with Nima V and Michael Dean. So much truth, it hurts.
Do you want to raise your children outside of the government indoctrination camps that are today's public schools? Check out the Ron Paul Curriculum link over on the right of freedomfiends.com. The Ron Paul Curriculum is a liberty-based K-12 homeschool course. It covers history, liberty, geography, math, science, and free market economics. Kindergarten through fifth grade are free. Then it's only $250 per family per year. Click on the Ron Paul Curriculum link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com.
Hey, this is Nathan Explosion from Death Clock, and you're listening to Freedom Fiends on the radio, Worms.
Love the Fiends and want to help out? We do take donations and we put them back into our Liberty projects. You can make a donation by clicking on the spinning coin on any post. But what if you want to help, but you ain't got no cash? Or you made a donation and you want to help more? Here's how you can help. Download and seed our torrents to help keep us drone-proof. There's a torrent club link at the top of freedomfiends.com. You can also blog the Fiends and share episode links on Facebook, Twitter, and elsewhere. You can rate and review our movies on Amazon and IMDb. You can rate and review the Freedom Fiends and our songs on iTunes. That really helps a lot. You can buy our movies and share them with friends or give them out as gifts. And one of the best ways to spread liberty is to buy a bunch of Freedom Fiends buttons and give them out as gifts. Wholesale prices are available, and you can also comment on our site, or better yet, comment about us on other sites. And please email the site link to all your friends. Thanks for helping spread the Fiends message worldwide to as many liberty people as you can, especially to those who don't yet get it. You rock.
Hi, I'm Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends, and like you, I'm concerned with privacy on the internet. The electronic police state is strangling our previous protections, and the central scrutinizer is trying to squint into all areas of our lives. That's why smart people surf the net with a VPN or virtual private network. I use a VPN from Bola VPN. Bola VPN has your utmost security in mind and will allow you to surf, email, and do other computing tasks without leaving a trail of breadcrumbs across the internet. Unlike many other VPN providers, Bola VPN doesn't log traffic. With Bola VPN, you can change your apparent location or disappear completely. Bola VPN has been around since 2007, which is OG in the VPN world. Bola VPN is easy to install and configure. Best of all, it can be had for less than 25 cents a day, which is a small price to pay for this much security. And if you open a support ticket saying you heard about them through the Freedom Fiends, they'll add 3 extra days free. That's Bola VPN at BOLEHVPN.net. All right. This is the Freedom Fiends live talk radio show on Gold Saturday, November 30th. That's the day you go out and buy gold from freedomfiends.com. You go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link that says Midas Resources and buy gold. Or you also go and buy Bitcoin, or you go to the store, or you go to your neighbor and do some sort of exchange that's an A to B conversation, and everyone else can see their way out of it. All those tax collectors and rent seekers and people that just want to destroy America and destroy the world by being tyrants. All those people that want to have their finger up in your pie. And we had a little drone-type event in the background there. I thought Nima got droned. Mid-sentence, he just disappeared. It turned out that The power failed in Round Rock, Texas, but through the magic of the free market and consumer electronics and cell phones. And we do want to give out the number here. If you have a cell phone, or better yet, a landline, you can call in the Freedom Fiends at 1-855-660-4261. And right now on the phone, we have our co-host, Mr. Nima Vidotti. How you doing there, Nima?
Yeah, I'm doing pretty good. Yeah, I have a laptop, so I can still see my computer, I can still see my notes, but obviously the microphone is dead, the internet is dead. I guess I need one of those uninterrupted power supplies. Yeah. So the market would have fixed this problem, but I did not buy the necessary equipment. Shame on me, I should have went out and bought that yesterday.
Yep, well, I have that on my end, so we were still connected, and you connect to me, right. And then I connect to GCN, and then they connect to the satellites, and the satellites connect down to the radio stations, and then the radio stations send us out to the radios. That's the chain of command. So we only had enough money to buy unlimited power supplies for one end of that, so we started with me, since if I lose my power and I didn't have these uninterrupted power supplies, which we can buy. You can buy from Amazon by going to thefreedomfiends.com and clicking on the Amazon link. It doesn't cost you any extra, and we get a little taste. So we bought them for me first, and eventually we're going to buy them for you. That's another thing we would like donations and button sales for our Liberty mission. But I wanted to talk a little bit about something else that we got that I wrote. It's a book I wrote called A User's Manual for the Human Experience. And there's a lot of good reviews of it on Amazon. You can get it on Amazon. You can buy a paperback of it, or you can go to search it online and you can find a free audiobook of it. I gave it away as my gift to the world and also like to sell it. But Timothy Fanning wrote on Amazon and said, Mr. Michael Dean's book, A User's Manual for the Human Experience, helped me get out of the rubble I had made of my life. It inspired me to fight addiction, stop playing the victim, and to learn to recognize people that try to take advantage of my overly sympathetic nature and tell them no. I've read it approximately 5 times. It's very rare to find a book that I read all the way through to the end, let alone more than once. And that's why this book has 5 stars. I've recommended this book in person to at least 10 people, probably more. I've lost count. This work is a great tool to recalibrate my outlook towards life, relationships, productivity, and time management. That's a nice review, huh, Nima?
That's a real nice review, yeah. Well, kudos to you. And I know a lot of people have found lots of help through reading that book. When you first wrote it, somebody had told you, sort of an insider had told you, well, it's a little bit green for libertarianism, but I don't think it's green at all when it comes to personal self-help kind of a book.
Yeah.
And you kind of, from what I understand, take the principles, or at least some of the principles from AA, and apply them to people's personal lives. And one of the things I really like about it is the idea that there are some people who are serenity vampires, and they will try to suck the serenity out of you, and you must make sure that you don't let them do that.
Yep. Yeah, when people do that, they're basically acting like the government. The government, all governments, and we're not just bashing America, we love America. But all governments everywhere ruin people's lives. That's what they do. You know, they may provide a few services here and there, but of course they're overinflated for the market and provided at the point of a gun, and you don't have a choice. But far, far outweighing the so-called services they provide, they just crush everything. And they get to the point where, like, even things that may have been set up at one time to, like, prevent the big problems that were caused by things the government did, like, you know, cartel-like things in giant steel corporations, that ends up just crushing grandmothers who are, you know, teaching the neighborhood kids something cool like music. Yeah. Yeah.
When
go ahead.
One of the other things people always go off about is roads. But for the past month or two, I've been fighting horrendous battles constantly with the toll roads here in Texas, which are completely awful. And so my answer to people who say, well, who would build the roads, who would administer the roads, I'm sure companies that were a lot better and a lot more scrupulous than the Texas Tollway Association or whatever they call themselves, they do not treat me like a customer. They send us bills from months ago, even though we've been paying, bills that we get the feeling that they're hiding from us so that they can then charge us late charges. $50 per late charge, or $25 per fee, basically it cost me $250 for 1 day's worth of driving. What kind of market institution do you think would allow you, or think that the market would bear paying $250 for 2 days of driving?
Yeah. And this is, you know, the government, again, crushing the little guy. I mean, Nima's not the little guy. He's the big bold talk radio host. But, you know, we're semi-professional on this. We're keeping our amateur status so we can compete in the Olympics one day. Nima works 60 hours a week as a cable installer. You know, he's got a wife with a kid on the way. Anytime between now, you know, I thought maybe that's why you left real quick. I thought maybe her water broke and you just ran out the door to drive her to the hospital. But
I'd give you a heads up. I'd share that with the radio. Definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, but I want to talk a little bit about, you know, it was Thanksgiving. Someone said Claire Wolf, one of the OG old school libertarians we like a lot, had something on her blog that said, what are you thankful for? And someone named Brian A. said, Sam Colt, Oliver Winchester, Gaston Glock, Edward Snowden, Cody Wilson, and the Freedom Feens. That just made my day, man. Nice. That, like, we're on someone's Thanksgiving list of what they're thankful for. I like it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And that kind of stuff helps to keep us going, too. Somebody recently who sent us a very generous donation, when I went to thank him, he said, don't worry, man, it's long overdue. You guys are highly leveraged, but it will pay off. And yeah, I guess I kind of think about that. I mean, there's a lot of good that I think the liberty message has yet to do in the world, obviously. And that's what we're in the business of, is helping to get that message to as many people as possible. And so that's really that's the end here. You know, everything else is a means to getting that message to people, because I really think that that's the only thing that saves the world, is for people to stop putting their faith in violence and force as an organizing method for society, and to start putting their faith in freedom and the market and commerce as what can organize society to the benefit of everyone, because it'll be a net gain, because there won't be a middleman taking a chunk out of every transaction.
Yeah, and I want to talk a little bit not just about what we're thankful about, but what we like that we have in common with patriot types and why we're different. Okay, we love individualism. We love being left alone. We love religious freedom. Nima says he loves barbecue and pecan pie, although that's a Texan thing, which, you know, actually barbecue came from Spain and pecan pie came from France. But, you know, anybody who has this idea of like everything must be American, you know, it's like everything that you do every day involves some other country, you know, every item, yeah. That, you know, or, you know, you go to school. What are you taught? You're taught, in the words of Amiri Baraka in my Hubert Selby movie, you know, you go to college, you're taught, you know, English literature, you know, French drama, German philosophy. You know, America is a melting pot, and we love the melting pot of it. And really what the melting pot means is a bunch of people left alone to combine voluntarily their ideas. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they can keep what they want. If the government gets out of the way, they can keep what they want. You don't need a rule or a law to say, this kind of immigrants keep out, or this kind of, you know, basically, if you took away all the welfare and if you took away all of the silly laws, I'd have no problem with opening up borders. And that's like heresy to a lot of people. But hey, put it this way, man, I would gladly trade, you know, a million lazy tax eater Americans and people that want Americans that want to tyrannize people for a million hardworking Mexicans or a million hardworking anybody. Seriously.
Right. Right. Yeah. Your nationality, where you were born, is an accident. Right. So that doesn't matter. That doesn't factor in. At least it shouldn't. And you can press people who are very anti-Chinese on, oh, you can't buy Chinese, you must only buy American. Say, hey, well, what about the traditional goods of a country? Are you saying we shouldn't buy that? Should we not buy Belgian chocolate, you know, or Japanese kimonos, or any of the goods that the countries are traditionally known
or
for?
Belgium makes the best rifle in the world, man, the FN FAL. Yeah. I'd love to have an FN FAL, yeah, which is a mind-blowingly good weapon for a country whose military history basically consists of waving Nazis through the border.
Nazis, sure. I was going to say, in World War One, the Belgians apparently put up a pretty decent fight against the German war machine. I mean, they lost in the end, but they didn't take it sitting down. They blew up bridges and tried to halt the advance. But I guess your Nazis thing, maybe that's a different story. But here's the other thing is, if the good got to your door, I would pretty much guarantee that some American made some money off of it. And maybe that's how he's feeding his kids. Maybe that trucker feeds his kids and puts his kids through college delivering those goods to the store that you then buy them from.
Yeah.
There's importers or exporters or retailers that are involved in that transaction. I mean, go back and read iPencil. I mean, you can't just pin down a good to one source and say there's only this one person making money off of this transaction. The complex market economy lets everyone make some money off of it, or not everyone, but lets multiple people be involved in making money off of getting that good to your made and to your doorstep.
Yeah. Yeah, unlimited free markets are creators of wealth, and governments interfering with them in any way, you know, even if it's something you don't like if you don't like pot, we don't smoke pot. Pot makes people stupid. I don't mind that people want to smoke it and make themselves stupid. I think that's their right. I'm a lot more upset, or I'm not even upset about that. I'm extremely upset about the fact that the government has this police force that goes kicking in doors for things that aren't immoral, that don't harm anyone, and not even the person that's using it. Pot doesn't harm people. It makes you stupid for a little while, but the next day you're not stupid. And I don't have any problem
It makes some people stupid, and it makes some people stupid at some things, but it's also unique. People react differently to different drugs. I think that's another important thing, especially which goes back to the consumerist thing that, oh, we should all just have one soap, is that people's needs are infinite, and they're also very different and unique.
Yep, and we'll have more when we come back from the free market here on the Freedom Feens.
Worms.
You're listening to Freedom Feens with Nima V and Michael Dean. They'll be right back just as soon as this drone is out of range. Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
You're listening to the Freedom Feens talk radio show, syndicated on Genesis Communications Network and your local radio affiliate. And I'm using my NPR voice, and I don't really mean to, because I'm broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker in an undisclosed location. So, Nima Vadavi, America is so rich that the American government sends men in helicopters to pick your weeds. What do you think of that?
What do you mean by that?
Well, a listener in Atlanta named Samantha, a lady named Samantha, wrote us and said that. She said she and her husband were talking about how if someone came from another planet, or if, you know, like the world was covered in ash right now and they dug it out hundreds of years from now, they would look at these drug raid cops, you know, rappelling down ropes into people's, you know, wild gardens back in the woods to steal all their marijuana plants. They might look at that as like, oh, it was so wealthy of a society that the government sent men in helicopters to pick your weeds. How nice was that? And, you know, you think about like how bad the economy is, how wrecked it is, how bad 220 years of Democrats and Republicans stealing from the future to get votes has led. Mm-hmm. And what it's led to, like led to like people can't make it, even working lots of hours a week and two jobs and both parents working. And yet you've still got this immensely funded group of thugs that have helicopters and night vision and computer networks and encrypted radios and salaries and pensions. And their job is to go steal weeds, basically. What do you make of that?
And helicopters. Think about how expensive it is just to get from point A to B and thermally image it, and all the hours they're paying these guys. It is. You're right. And I think that's a good tactic, is to take a step back and try. I mean, it's impossible to be objective, but try to view it. Do a thought experiment. Try to view society as how it would be seen by an outsider. And I think that's, the drug war is something that would just probably boggle somebody's mind. And yeah, they might go so far as to think it's something that it's not.
I look at it like it really I think it would be looked at by future generations the way that we now look at like women being accused of being witches and being burned at the stake, or at slavery. It's how ridiculous were those things? You know, those were small minds, but they were controlling governments or controlling the church, which was acting like the government, which had armies behind it. And there's two or three different ways you can look at any kind of tyranny. You can look at it from a moral standpoint of it's immoral to have people kicking in doors and taking plants from people. If you can't wrap your head around that, if you're not a moral enough person to wrap your head around that, you can look at it from an economic standpoint. We cannot afford, you know, as a nation, and I'm thinking collectively here, but as a nation, we cannot afford to be paying for that when everybody's out of work. Oh, yeah, you're making jobs for those people, but at the detriment of destroying lives. You know, when they catch people with those plants that don't hurt anybody, they ruin their lives. They go to jail. They have to get lawyers. They lose their job. They can't get a job. They lose their kids. They lose their home while they're in jail. It destroys the economy. Now, if you can't even look at it that way, if you're so square, you know, like the guy said in the Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom movie, you know,
The people who think that nobody should get a welfare check, and we agree no one should get a welfare check, a lot of those same people, the right winger, like, we have to crush drugs, those same people who would never give someone a welfare check voluntarily are the same people that don't mind throwing someone in jail, paying for their food, their clothing, their housing, their medical care, and the guards to keep them in that cell. I mean, how ridiculous is that? But if you can't look at the moral aspect of it or the economic aspect of it, I just bring it back to, those people training to kick, those people kicking in doors are the same people that are going to be kicking in your doors to take guns when they legalize pot and outlaw guns as a political move in a few years.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Oh, man. It just boggles my mind that people don't see it. And I almost get the sense that there's no excuse anymore because all of this information is so freely exchanged. All of these ideas, it's not like people don't hear them. From even from their grandchildren, if that's what they're hearing it from. And maybe you can't teach old dogs new tricks, I don't know. Maybe it's a generational thing. But I think on a long enough timeline, the truth wins out in the end. And I think that we have that on our side. So I guess that's my redemption in the third act here.
Thank you, Nima. And this has been the Freedom Feens. Go to our site, freedomfiends.com, for all our feeny goodness. We'll be back tomorrow with Ed and Ethan on the Freedom Feens.
Thank you for listening to Freedom Feens with Nima V and Michael Dean. Make an appointment to listen while it's still legal. Learn more about the Feens and download archived shows at freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.